In a time of need, and find help and mercy in that time of need. So I love the invitation to come boldly to a throne room of grace and not hesitate, because God knows everything about us. He knows our vulnerabilities, He knows our weaknesses, He knows our failures, and He knows the kind of pressures we're under. And yet He says, come boldly to the throne room of grace. There's an invitation to access a realm of the supernatural favor of God, His goodness, His blessing, and to know that greater is He that's in us than he that's in the world. And no matter the pressure coming against you from the outside, you and I can always know that what's in us is greater than what's coming from the outside. And so we've been doing this great series on the ingredients for the miraculous, for healing. We're getting reports of more and more people being healed in different places. We're so grateful for that. And believe me, we're growing in momentum. And the word is being sown, and it's a seed that is growing in people's hearts, and it will produce all by itself. While you're sleeping, while you're awake, the word of God is producing and working effectively on the inside of you, and it's changing the way we think. So this is a washing of the water of the word again today. I want to answer the question, what was Paul's thorn in the flesh? Now, this is a very, very key question to answer accurately, wisely, and in the context of Scripture. What was Paul's thorn in the flesh? Now, answering this incorrectly has produced tragedy for hundreds of years around the world. Getting this question wrong about Paul's thorn in the flesh has robbed literally millions and millions of people from the privilege and their rights to supernatural, miraculous healing. So I want to say today, we need to get this answer to this question right. Okay, so the false teaching, which is the unbelief of religious traditions, which has demons or doctrines of demons behind this teaching, false teaching says that Paul's thorn in the flesh is a sickness that God gave to him, and they'll teach that Paul prayed three times for God to take the sickness away, and God refused to take the sickness away. That is a complete lie, and we'll show you quickly now through the Scriptures how powerful this teaching is and how clear it really is. Firstly, I just want to say that thorn in the flesh is a common term used throughout Scripture in many different places. And the symbol or the term thorn in the flesh never refers to sickness in the Scripture at all. And so we'll read now quickly in Numbers chapter 33:55. Thorn in the flesh means human opposition. If you were sitting out today, I'd say thorn in the flesh means human opposition. Thorn in the flesh means human persecution and human opposition to the gospel of grace. So let's just read this. It's in Numbers 33, verse 55. But if you do not drive out the inhabitants of the land, those you allow to remain will become barbs in your eyes and thorns in your sides. They will give you trouble in the land where you will live. So this is what the thorn in the flesh is. It's human opposition. And we'll read that very clearly in a moment. But Paul, in his letters and in the book of Acts, you will see the very brutal and vicious persecution and opposition Paul had. A messenger from Satan stirred up crowds and stirred up wicked and evil religious people to attack Paul over and over again, to discourage him, to stop him from preaching the gospel of grace, to hinder him, and to make him so oppressed with pressure that the demonic wanted him to give up. But Paul found sufficiency of grace, and Paul grew in strength even through these times of opposition. So let me say this so clearly. The thorn in the flesh is 100% not sickness. It is not disease. It is opposition from a messenger of Satan to buffet Paul or to torment him. The word buffet means to hit over and over again. It's like a wave hitting up against the side of a boat. Paul was buffeted and tormented by people who stirred up by Satan to attack him, to oppose him, to reject him, and to persecute him. So let's just before Paul talks about the thorn in the flesh, let's read the context. Just a few verses before he starts talking about the context of the thorn in the flesh, and then we'll read that. So let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. I believe it'll come up on your screen, which is fantastic. Such good technology here. So let's read this. Now, before we read this, I don't want you to be frightened. It's unlikely you will go through anything like this. Paul had a real hard time because he was the first apostle clearly carrying the message of grace into the nations of the earth. And there are people around the world who are currently going through some very difficult things, and we have lost thousands of Christians around the world in the last few years who've died as martyrs, have been tortured and imprisoned and beaten up for preaching the gospel. So this is a very real thing. But you see, persecution comes in different ways. And everyone in Hong Kong that preaches the gospel of grace, everyone in America, everyone in South Africa, anyone in any part of the world that preaches the message of grace passionately and clearly with signs and wonders, and you after God with all your heart and you are passionate, yes, the enemy will try to give you a thorn in the flesh, which is opposition, persecution, to discourage you. And you will find out today you can fly high in the grace of God and become happier and more joyful and even delight in insults and hardships and difficulties because it's for Christ's sake. And this is a new level and a new dimension of grace and favor. It excites you to know that you've been found worthy to be persecuted and hated because you are standing up under the anointing and you're not hiding, afraid like a coward. You are letting the world know the gospel of Jesus Christ, letting the world know God is a healing God, a miracle God. God is a good God. God is a God of favor, and He loves the nations of the earth. And so let's look at what Paul calls the thorn in the flesh. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and this is just a little part of it, verse 23 to 29. Besides everything else, I face daily the pressure of my concern for all the churches. So let's go back now to verse 23. I'll just read. Yeah, okay, here we go. Verse 23. Are they servants of Christ? I'm out of my mind to talk like this. I am more. I have worked much harder, been in prison more frequently, been flogged, which has been whipped more severely, and been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. On average, people would die at the 40 or 41st lash. So they would stop it just before the person died. 5 times Paul went through this. 5 times. I'm going, what? What? Been flogged more severely, been exposed to death again and again. 5 times I received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 time I was pelted with stones. That's putting it a nice way. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open. See, I've been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my fellow Jews, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, and in danger from false believers. There are false believers around, by the way. I have labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and naked. Now, I know that's severe stuff, but did you notice Paul never mentioned sickness once? How dare people say his thorn in the flesh was a disease or it was a sickness? It never was. It was human opposition. It was human persecution. It was evil religious people who were legalistic that Satan had sent a messenger to stir them up to attack Paul. Let's be clear on that. He never mentions sickness once. He mentions human persecution and opposition. That's very clear. So now let's just drop down to chapter 12 where Paul starts talking about the thorn in the flesh. This is just a few verses after where we've stopped reading. So 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 6 to 10. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassing great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it. Where am I? To take it away from me. There you go. To take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I'm weak, then I am strong. Paul is saying there that God's power is perfected in his weakness. This is something that Christians need to understand, that the Lord never uses people who are proud and trust in their natural strength or their natural talents or their natural abilities. Everyone that God has used, he's used them because of their humility. He's used them because they are not wise in their own eyes. They are not self-sufficient. They understand that they are weak. You see, weakness, human weakness, is actually the secret to becoming great in the purposes of God. God does not operate through people that use their natural strength. God operates through people that are weak. When Gideon said to the Lord, Lord, you know, I am of the least and of the weakest tribe, God said, you'll go in my power. Gideon became one of the greatest conquerors and the greatest generals, yet he was most afraid to be a general. He was most afraid to lead the army. He was literally hiding in a wine vat, and he had no confidence, no natural ability, and God chooses the weak. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 says, not many wise, not many noble, not many strong are chosen, but God chooses the weak and the foolish things of this world to expose the arrogant wisdom of this corrupted world. So God's looking for weakness. He's not looking for our strength. And that word weakness there does not mean sickness. If you read Romans 8:26, Paul clearly says, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we don't know what we ought to pray or what we should be praying for, but the Holy Spirit helps us in our weaknesses and leads us in intercession and shows us how to pray for things we don't know. When you're weak, you attract the power of God. When you are humble, when you are aware that you cannot cope with the opposition, you can't cope with persecution, you can't cope with the rejection, and you humble yourself, the mighty power of God comes upon you. Paul's difficulties, his hardships, were never sickness, they were never disease. Now, let me explain something to you that I think is very important for people to understand. The question is, when Paul asked God to take this thorn away, because you've got to understand, this is a messenger from Satan. He's trying to oppose Paul. Listen, God did not give Paul this messenger from Satan. You don't throw your children over the fence to the neighbor's vicious dogs for the dogs to discipline or train your children. God did not hand Paul over to the messenger of Satan. Neither will he ever hand you over to the messenger of Satan for the messenger of Satan to buffet you and to humble you. The devil's just coming anyway because he doesn't want the grace message to get out. He is a miracle, anti-miracle spirit. He hates the miracle power of God. He hates the message of grace. He wants to control people. He wants people to be racist. He wants people to be divided. He wants people to be lost. He wants people to go to hell with him. He wants to take people to hell. He wants to deceive people. He knows he's going to hell. Every demon knows they're all going to hell. They cannot be redeemed. They don't want this world to be redeemed. So they want this world to be under legalistic law where no one can get saved. They don't want any miracles to happen. They want to distort the image and goodness of the loving nature of God. So they want people to think God's making them sick. This is what the religious demon is all about. So here's the question. When Paul said, please, Lord, would you take this buffeting and this torment and these persecutions and hardships, would you take it off me? The Lord says, my grace is sufficient for you. And Paul learned this. He really learned this, that he could find in God grace to deal with persecution, grace to deal with rejection, grace to deal with hardship. This is amazing. He even says, I therefore delight in insults, for it is for Christ's sake. If we can see this as authentic apostolic Christianity, today we've got on the earth something that is not Christianity. It is some new Christian traditional religion that it has nothing to do with the Word of God and nothing to do with the kingdom and nothing to do with the gospel of grace. Paul was standing for the gospel of grace, and he paid a price in that he had to face opposition. Yet he ends up saying, I delight in these hardships. I delight in insults and in difficulties and in weaknesses, because when I am weak, the power of God is made perfect in me. This is the message that produces a generation of people that are bold, for they're living with eternity in mind. They're living with a passion for Jesus Christ. They are not just churchgoers. They are not religious. They are people of the kingdom. Here's the question. It's a good theological question. Why did God not take the persecution off Paul? Why didn't he take the persecution off Paul? Why didn't God protect Paul the apostle from persecution? It's a good question. Well, here's the answer. 2 Timothy chapter 3, let's read it here. 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 12 says, Paul writes this himself. He says, in fact, everyone, say everyone, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. There is a promise in the Word of God, a guarantee that if you're living a godly life, you will be persecuted. Now, what is a godly life? Is it being legalistic? Is it being religious? Is it being weird? No. A godly life is living a life like Paul the Apostle. A godly life is living a life like Jesus Christ himself, who we're meant to imitate and be conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus. If you live with a passion to honor your Father, you are going counterculture to this corrupted age. If you live a life in the grace of God and believe in God's grace and his goodness, you're going counterculture to the corrupted wisdom of legalism and to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you walk in the supernatural power of God and you live your life in a way that honors God, like, and we're not talking about self-righteousness, but it's a good when a man and a woman stay married and don't commit adultery and don't just run around. And the world today is showing off such immoral things. It is so corrupted, it is so deceitful and conceited, and it's flaunting the most evil, ugly, immoral behavior and acting like this is normal. It is not normal. And if you live like Christ Jesus, and if you live like the apostolic grace that was in Paul, and then the great examples of the great heroes of the faith down through the centuries, if you live like they lived, you will change destiny. You will change history. You'll change nations. You'll change villages and towns, and you'll affect the way people think. But you will suffer persecution, for anyone who lives a godly life will suffer persecution. Now, there's no condemnation here, but I just want to ask you, have you ever suffered any persecution for your stand for Christ? Because if you've never suffered persecution, you are not living a godly life. You are fitting in with the pattern of this world. You're conforming to what unbelievers think and do, and you're not disturbing their world one little bit. You just like them. But if you begin in compassion and in love and thinking about these beautiful people are going to hell, they're lost, they're cut off from God, they've been deceived by a devil that hates them, and they don't believe in the goodness of God's grace. If that awakens in you and you begin to speak and teach the gospel to them, you begin to pray for the sick, you begin to step out and you do what it takes to keep your marriage in a good place, you work at raising your children, and you stay faithful in tough times and in difficult times, and you don't live for yourself, you don't live for what's easy and what to do when you feel like doing it. If you live for the Father, you will face opposition, but you will have sufficiency of grace. You will have adventures. You will be excited. You'll be living with adrenaline, because there'll be times you're going, the pressure's coming. What do I do? God will turn up for you every time, and you will get stronger, and you'll get stronger, and you'll get stronger. So that's number one reason why God doesn't take away persecution from those that live a godly life. But here's the main reason and the main revelation. For God to have stopped the persecution coming at Paul the Apostle, God would have had to do either one of two things. He would have had to take away mankind's free will and just make them not persecute Paul, or he would have had to kill the people that were persecuting Paul. And so God's not going to take people's free will away, because no one could get saved without free will. And God doesn't want to just kill people because they're persecuting us. Yeah, you need to see this. This is a very big thing now. Paul the apostle, before he was a believer in Christ, his name was Saul of Tarsus, and he was a murderous persecutor of Christians. Thank God didn't kill Saul. Thank God he didn't just take Saul's free will away. Thank God, because you see, Saul was angry with Christians. Saul was pulling Christians out of synagogues and signing their death warrants and for them to be put to death. That's what Saul was doing. And Saul was there in Acts 7 when Peter, this great man of faith and power, who stood up against this most brutal, religious, demonic, oppressive regime in Jerusalem. He stood up under the power of God. And it says Stephen was so anointed that even these trained religious scholars did not know how to answer him because of the spirit by which Stephen spoke. In fact, eventually these trained evil religious scholars began to gnash their teeth at Stephen, and finally they grabbed his clothes and split them up, and finally they stoned him to death. And the Bible says that Jesus stood at the right hand of the Father, and Stephen saw the glory of an open heaven, and Jesus giving Stephen a salute and honoring him with a standing ovation. Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul the apostle, Saul of Tarsus was standing there guarding the clothes of those stoning Stephen, and he saw the way Stephen died in humility. He saw the way Stephen died without bitterness. Stephen, being killed by stones, cried out, "O Lord, do not hold this sin against him." While Saul, the persecutor, the one who has been used by Satan as a buffeter of the flesh of Christians, that very man Saul, on the road to Damascus to go and kill more Christians, the Holy Spirit met Saul, and the glory of God came, and Saul had an encounter with God, and it changed his life supernaturally, and he became a believer in Christ. And God spoke to Paul when he had just got saved, And he said, "I'm going to show you how much you must suffer for my name." And Paul became one of the greatest apostles that have ever lived. And he that was a persecutor, he became the greatest proponent of grace. So you see, God is not going to just kill the people that persecute the church. He's not going to just shut down their free will. You see, on the cross, Christ redeemed us from sickness. He redeemed us from disease. He redeemed us by stripes we're healed. He forgave all of our sins. All of our iniquities were put on Jesus. The punishment for our peace was put on Jesus. But Jesus didn't carry away persecution at the cross. There's no promise in the Word of God that He'll save us from persecution. There's no promise that we're redeemed from persecution. The only time there'll be no more persecution is when we're in heaven and gone to our heavenly rewards. And I pray that we would have lived the life that warranted being persecuted because of our faithfulness to Jesus. So when we get to heaven, we'll know what it's like to not have any persecution whatsoever. But in this life, the Bible does not say the cross has redeemed us from persecution. In this world, we're in a war zone. We're in a planet that's a rebellion. It's in rebellion against God. Yet we are bringing in the kingdom and we are moving the devil out. I hope you can say amen and amen to that. Now, this is the thing. Paul the Apostle, you know, these theologians that have said Paul the Apostle had a sickness, a disease, an eye infection, and a whole lot of other silly things they said. They said he had all kinds of sicknesses. And the Paul the Apostle preached vigorously and energetically right across the known world. He was going and going and ministering and working hard for the gospel, facing persecution and difficulties, but he kept going. Now, isn't that amazing that you've got people today who claim they've got a thorn in the flesh? They claim that God has given them a sickness for some mysterious holy reason, and that they've just got to suffer it, and they prayed and asked God to take it away 3 times, and God has kept them sick. And that many of those people who believe that lie are incapacitated, are not serving God. They're lying around sick for months or years, doing nothing for the kingdom because they say they've got a thorn in the flesh, a sickness given to them from God, and He won't heal them. That is a lie. They should be healed if they understood the gospel and the finished work of the cross. Paul was not sick. He might have got sick for a while here and there, but he didn't live with a thorn in his flesh, sick That wasn't God. That thorn in the flesh was persecution and hardships, not sickness. Paul went from village to village, year after year, for over 40 years, energetically serving God and preaching across nations of the earth. Then you get these other people, they say, no, this sickness is my thorn in the flesh. God gave it to me. I asked God to set me free from this sickness 3 times, and he told me to keep my sickness. Then they go to a doctor and ask a doctor or surgeon to heal them. Listen, they're just turning that doctor into a rebel against God's will. If it's God's will for them to have that sickness, and God doesn't want them to be healed, why make a doctor or a surgeon a rebel against the will of God? See, it's all silly and it's all nonsense. I just want to say, let's keep the scripture in context. Let's keep the scripture clear. Paul's thorn in the flesh was sickness. It was persecution, hardships, insults, and difficulties to try to get him to stop preaching the gospel, to try to get him to give in and surrender and become a law preacher again and just become religious again and deny the world signs, wonders, miracles, and healings and the freedom that there is in the gospel of grace. See, Europe went into the dark ages for over 1,000 years. There was no science, no invention. There was no human rights. Religion dominated and controlled. And it took a man like Martin Luther to rise up and start recovering the gospel of grace. When Martin Luther, 400 years ago, began to see the gospel of grace, science came into Europe and human rights came and education came. Because without the gospel of grace, the nations go back into darkness, racism and control and abuse and loss of freedoms. So we are standing for a gospel that the devil doesn't want. He wants a false gospel. He wants a gospel mixed with law and grace and confused with old covenant, new covenant. They just condemn God's people because he knows he wants to bring darkness and steal people's freedoms. But we are standing for something bigger than just church. We are standing for nations. We're standing for eternity. And so the opposition that comes, I tell you what, God wants to stop people's free will and he won't kill them to stop them persecuting us, but he certainly turned Saul of Tarsus around for the good when Saul saw the way Stephen died under grace. And certainly after Paul became a great apostle of grace, and he himself was now being persecuted, they cast out a demon in Philippi of this woman that was a fortune teller. She was operating by a demon, and the people were making a lot of money out of her for telling fortunes. Paul and Silas cast the demon out of her in the name of Jesus, and unjustly and without a court process, they were Roman citizens as well as Jews. They were put in jail unjustly. They were whipped. This is the thorn in the flesh. They were beaten with stripes in that jail till they were bleeding at midnight. They were not like modern Christians complaining, how can God love me? What kind of God is this? They understood they were not redeemed from persecution. They understood there was opposition. And they started worshiping and praising God at midnight, literally at midnight with bleeding backs. Unjust context. What had been done to them was wicked and evil. They were being obedient to the Father. They were in the will of God, and they end up in prison, bleeding and beaten in the inner stockade. And what do? They start praising and worshiping God because they found God's grace sufficient. They didn't need inner healing. They didn't need someone to come and say, oh, you poor little things. God hasn't been fair to you. What kind of God is this? They knew their God is good. They knew this thorn in the flesh never came from their Father. It's from the demonic trying to stop the message of grace, trying to stop Christians going to church, trying to stop Christians believing the Word of God, trying to stop Christians being bold and moving in signs and wonders. They worship God at midnight. And what did God do? Came and shook that whole prison. The doors fell open, and the prison warden and his entire family got saved, got born again on their way to heaven. Then the magistrates released Paul and Silas, and then a church was planted in the Philippines, a glorious, thriving, healthy church that Paul writes to in his letters. Out of that persecution, what the devil meant for evil, because Paul and Silas understood the thorn in the flesh is not sickness, it's opposition from human beings. But behind that opposition is a messenger from Satan to stop you preaching the message of grace, to make you afraid of rejection so that you just fit in with the normal so-called Christian. But I tell you, Paul set a standard. He set something for future generations that we need to be that apostolic culture, that all the apostles were like this, all 12 and all the apostles after the resurrection of Jesus. So let me just, I want to read this something to you here that let us examine the contradiction and the ungodly consequences that follow this false teaching that Paul's thorn in the flesh had nothing to do with persecution but was a sickness that God refused to heal him from. This false teaching on Paul's thorn in the flesh has allowed Christians to be passive and resigned to sickness, but equally a problem, they are not able or prepared or taught how to cope with opposition, persecution, and rejection from people. It has produced weird Christians that are unstable, fickle, unfaithful. They are not able to endure hardships. The true teaching that the thorn in the flesh is not sickness from God, but it is human beings attacking you with insults and opposition. That true teaching will produce a generation of Christians who are secure in grace, not confused and surprised by opposition. They learn to drink deeply from the fountain of grace that supplies them with the capacity to delight in difficulties, knowing it's for Christ's sake, just as Paul and Silas did in the jail in Philippi. The outcome was salvation for many. False teaching on Paul's thorn in the flesh produces many Christian cowards. While I was still living in Australia, continually God spoke to me for about 3 years about this very subject. And he said, and I'm quoting the prophetic word of God to me, he said this to me, "For the assignment I'm giving to you, Rob, will require complete deliverance from the addiction to human approval. Right across my church worldwide, there is an addiction to human approval by many of my people. For they do not look to me for my perfect approval through my grace. This addiction to human approval has stopped my people from obeying me because they're afraid of rejection or persecution. That has controlled my people to conform to the pattern of this world. Rob, I'm going to deliver you and wean you off this dangerous addiction. I will fill you with courage, and you will stand up with a supernatural trumpet in your voice and preach the true gospel of grace with signs and wonders. You will suffer persecution and rejection, but you will liberate many who want the truth." Close inverted commas. "For the next 6 years, I went through many attacks. Not sickness, but Satan stirring up legalistic people to lie about me, to distort. They wanted me to distort the truth. I was betrayed many times. It was psychologically extremely painful. But I'm eternally grateful that I found the grace of God is very sufficient. All the pressure that people were trying to put on me was to get me to dilute the truth about grace, dilute the truth about signs, wonders, and miracles, dilute the truth of living for Christ with eternity in mind. They wanted me to mix the law and grace together in a confusing way. But by the grace of God, I did not give in to that. If I had have compromised the grace of God because this thorn in the flesh, I would have become a false minister." I want to say that again. Behind this is a messenger from Satan trying to get you to compromise. If I'd have given in to the pressure of this messenger from Satan, I would have become a false minister of the gospel today, a fraudulent leader, and even worse, I would have submitted to the messenger of Satan and let something very evil define what I preach. Those who surrender to what is behind the thorn in the flesh condemn themselves to preach a false gospel that has already deceived millions and millions of multitudes around the world. His grace is sufficient. You can stand. His power is made perfect in our weakness. Be bold. The promotion of religious politics is a snare and it is a trap. When the Father promotes you, His honor will follow you all the days of your life. I want to close with this here. Just one more thing. How's our time here? What time did we start here? How long have I been going? Are you serious? No, I've been going longer than half an hour. No. Serious? Oh my gosh. Man, so intense. Okay. All right. Well, 35 minutes. I was intense trying to finish this quickly. I thought I'd be longer. Oh my gosh. How are you guys doing? Are you drinking coffee or You're watching this later in the afternoon. You had a good morning at the beach. I hope you did have a good morning. All right. Now, there's so much more I could talk on the subject, but I just want to just bring another perspective here. You'll see this in, we're not going to read it. We don't even have it on our passages here. But in Galatians 4, you can read it in your own time, in 13 to 16, Paul, in the Passion or in the NIV translation, he says that when he came to the Galatians, he came to them in a state of bad health. That's the wording he used. Or he had infirmity in his flesh. He was in a poor state of health. In other words, he was talking about his very appearance to them looked pretty bad, and that they were very gracious to him and very loving to him. And now immediately, people have taken that up and said, you see, the Galatians said, we'd pull our very eyes out for you. And they're saying, you see, Paul had an eye disease, and he had all pus coming out of his eyes, and that was his thorn in the flesh. And you see, they're just twisting the context to suit their narrative of unbelief and the very damnable doctrine of this deception about the thorn in the flesh. Because this church is the Galatian church that Paul preached to. And in Galatia, there were the cities of Lystra, Derbe, and Iconium. Now, if you will read, I want to read to you what happened to Paul 24 hours before he arrived at Galatia, looking pretty bad and looking pretty messed up. And you decide for yourself whether it was sickness or something else. I say to you from the clear scripture, and you'll see it now, Paul did not arrive in Galatia with any disease or any sickness. He arrived in ill health due to something different, due to the very thing called persecution and violent and brutal treatment of this apostle. Had nothing to do with the disease. So you'll see here, this is now 24 hours before Paul gets to Galatia. It says here in verse 19 of Acts chapter 14, verse 19, it says, some of the Jews who had opposed Paul, see, he has the thorn in the flesh, opposition, persecution. Some of the Jews who had opposed Paul and Barnabas in Antioch and Iconium arrived and stirred up the crowd against him. They stoned Paul. Everyone say, stone Paul. They stoned Paul and dragged his body outside the city and left him for dead. When the believers encircled Paul's body, he miraculously stood up. Paul stood and immediately went back into the city. The next day, say the next day, this is within 24 hours, the next day he left with Barnabas for Derbe. Now friends, this is where he met the Galatian church. They weren't a church yet. They heard the gospel from Paul for the first time. When he gets there, he's not looking good. He's looking devastatedly broken up. Why? Because he has been stoned and left for dead. We don't know if he was dead or not, or whether he was unconscious and was resuscitated. Whatever the case, anyone who knows anything about stoning, there's a restriction on the size of the rock. You can't use too small a rock because that will never kill the person. The object of stoning is to kill the person. That you're not allowed to use rocks that are too big because you'll kill the person too fast. It's too easy for them. So you've got to use medium-sized rocks that will literally, you throw them into the person's face and into their body. And so angry, demonized messenger from Satan stirred up men to throw into the face of this glorious, graced apostle of Jesus Christ through rocks. This is the spirit of religion. This is the spirit of anti-miracles. If it were not for some governments in the nations of the earth that would outlaw this kind of stuff, more Christians would be experiencing this stuff, because they are in certain countries. That's the spirit that's against the kingdom and against signs and wonders and against the message of grace. They throw rocks into his face and into his body until he falls either dead or unconscious. And they leave him there. And the brothers in Christ come and stand around him. And the power of God raises Paul up. And he goes straight back into the city of Derbe. And the next morning he sets out on a 40-kilometer journey about. He's walking the day after he's been left dead for stoning. And he arrives amongst the Galatians in a state. Listen, he wasn't sick. He'd just been stoned. How would you look like? What would you think of me if I just got raised from the dead for being stoned? What would my face look like? What would your face look like? What would your body look like? How could this man have even been preaching within 24 hours of being stoned? That is supernatural. And they're wanting to pull their eyes out. Was like today in our modern world, someone that we love, we'd say, if we could cut our arm off and give it to you, we would. That's what they were saying. It was a saying. His face was broken. His eyes were puffy. And they had compassion on him. And look what he said. He preached the great gospel of grace to them, just having been stoned. Imagine Christians today, if they'd been stoned, would they be preaching 24 hours later? What kind of Christianity is this? What kind of boldness is this? It amazes me. I wish I could say I'm living at that level, but I aspire to that. I don't want to look at some Christians. They're so lukewarm and pathetic. They're the ones that kept me out the kingdom. They're so weak in the wrong way. They're so nice and cute. They don't want to offend anybody. They don't want to preach the truth. They don't want to be persecuted. They don't want anyone to reject them, especially anyone in their family. But I tell you what, I can deal with a guy like Paul. After preaching, he gets stoned by evil people. He gets up after being left for dead, walks 40 kilometers, and 24 hours later is preaching to the Galatians. No wonder he was of ill health or infirmity in his flesh. He had just been stoned, but yet he found sufficiency in God's grace. And while he's recovering from this in Galatia, he is planting the church and establishing the Galatians in the message of grace. Wow, that for me is amazing. And look what he preached. Look what he said. Wherever he went in those areas, this is what he preached in Galatians 14, verse 22. Oh, that's fine. Okay, let me read it from my notes here. It's in everyone's notes as well, so you will have it on your phone if you've downloaded it. Anyway, so this is what Paul says. Bring us to end now. This is what Paul said. After he'd been stoned, okay, this is 24 hours, 30 hours, 48 hours now. He's going around, and this is the center of his message. It says this in Acts 4, 22. At each place that he went, they strengthened the lives of the believers and encouraged them to go deeper in their faith. And they taught them, it is necessary for us to enter into the realm of God's kingdom because that's the only way we will endure many trials and persecutions. He has apostolic teaching. He has the wisdom of apostolic foundation teaching for the people of the kingdom today that you need to enter in deeper into the kingdom. Not just when you get to heaven, but the kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Enter into the supernatural. Enter into the government of God's grace. Enter into the throne room of grace. Draw from the sufficiency of grace. Because if you don't, you will not deal with persecution and you will not deal with difficulties. According to wisdom, you will surrender to the messenger of Satan and surrender to an evil spirit and conform to the religious pattern of this world. And you will not fulfill your destiny. You'll just eat food, pass it through your body, get old, and have wasted your life and mismanaged your future generations. It is time for the church to go back to the scriptures, to the word of God, and to be the people of God and not say, oh, well, there's an apostolic standard of Christianity and then there's a pastoral standard. There are not different gradings and categories. There is one kingdom of God and we are the people of the kingdom and we need to go deeper into the kingdom and deepen our faith, for this is the way we can endure persecutions. So closing, I love what Psalm 34 verse 19 says. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. Now, I'm not focusing on the word many. I'm focusing on the word all. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. In the midst of difficulty, in the midst of that time when I was being betrayed and books were being written about me and leaders were lying and twisting what I said about the message of grace, literally lying, not even communicating with me or even invited them to a context where we could talk and at least agree with a graciousness. They were avoiding that, many of them, and just lying. In that time of persecution, I felt the Lord say, son, hold your line, don't surrender, because I'm going to bring you out. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him from them all. Listen, it doesn't matter what thing you're going to go through, what hardships you have, what kind of lies people say against you to discourage you from preaching and teaching and sharing this gospel with your cousins, your aunties, your workmates, your co-workers, your family, with everybody you can. You need to, as much as possible, get this message of grace out. If you are persecuted and the hardships come, this is the truth. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Not sickness. Afflictions in the Hebrew there means trouble. Many are the troubles of the righteous. But the Lord delivers you from them all. Everyone say all. I have come out of all those troubles. All of those. Many of those leaders who attacked me have now repented and become believers in the grace message. Many of those leaders who were against this message now preach this grace message. Your example under pressure and persecution and opposition will bring transformation. Just like Saul, the persecutor, became Saul, the apostle of grace, and handled persecution in a godly way, that even after being stoned, he would still be preaching the message of grace. This is the privilege on our generation to produce people that stand for Christ like this. And then Jesus, our own Lord, said in John 16, verse 33, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Jesus overcame the world. Jesus went through the cross. Jesus went through persecution. He went through hatred from the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He overcame that spirit. He overcame the thorn in the flesh, and he won. And so did Paul, and so have millions of our brothers and sisters down through the centuries. Now, in 2020, God is raising up a church, getting ready in a time when the Spirit of God's going to be poured out across the nations of the earth, and he's reserved a faithful people that have not allowed persecution and rejection to cause them to shrink back and to go silent and just fit in. This group of people on the planet are ready to disciple millions of people who are going to be saved in the next couple of years. Two things we need to be able to show this generation coming. Number one, your father's a good father. He's a loving father. He never put sickness on you. All your sickness was put on Jesus. He took away your infirmities and your sicknesses and your diseases, and by stripes you have been healed. He is not putting sickness on you. Number two, prepare a generation to be courageous. Prepare a people to know that persecution and opposition and people criticizing you is normal for someone living a godly life. It is abnormal to have the absence of that. And prepare people to stand strong and be filled with grace and to find the sufficiency of God's grace, because it's for Christ's sake that you delight in this, for Christ's sake. So get ready, because there's something coming on the planet. Mighty outpouring of the Spirit. Those that submit to this persecution spirit, those that submit to this messenger from Satan who's trying to buffet people that stand up and preach the message of grace, those people who submit to that thorn in the spirit and that messenger of Satan, they submit to that, they come under that evil thing, they'll have no inheritance in this move of God that is coming right across the earth. Prepare a generation to know the Father's good. He's not making us sick. He's the God of miracles, and he's the God of healing. The devil is the liar. The devil is the one bringing opposition to you. But God delivers you out of them all. And every time you come out of some trouble, every time the Lord brings you through, every time he opens another Red Sea and you come out the other side and your enemy suffers, you get stronger and you get closer to God, and you separate your life and you begin to consecrate your life to walk with God in these days and be a man or woman with signs and wonders and miracles, sharing the gospel with people. Father, I thank you in Jesus' name for all the people of City Church International Hong Kong, and for those listening online from around the world or listening on the Cantonese Chinese feed. We bless all of you in the name of Jesus. We ask, Father, that this word would not be a passing word, but a word that would become pivotal and prophetic in all of our lives. It'll become definitive, that we're not here to win popular votes. We're not here to be nice politicians. We are here to be loving, gracious, humble, but boldly representing the kingdom of God, that we are ambassadors of the government of God, that we are citizens of heaven, and we are going to live our lives in eternity. This is not where we're living our lives. You've got a brief period on this earth. It'll be over soon, but we walk it with eternity in mind. So I decree, Father, grace. I decree a greater prayer life over every individual listening to me. I pray people would even more separate themselves to hear the voice of God and spend time alone with you, alone in your word, alone in prayer, waiting upon you. Lord, that we would supernaturally be endowed and imbued and endued with divine anointing and covenant grace and the mercy and the goodness and the favor of God to stand up unafraid and bold, full of courage in this time, and to find it's an honor to suffer for your name's sake. In Jesus' name, Lord, I pray signs and wonders and healings and miracles happen right now. I pray healing take place right now in people's physical bodies. People that have believed that the thorn in the flesh was a sickness that you didn't want to take away. Lord, I thank you. Their minds are delivered now. Truth sets free. I decree freedom, Father, that people will know you're a God who's good. You're a God that heals. You're a God of miracles. And you're a God who delivers us from all of our troubles. You bring us through every attack and every difficulty. You bring us out in all sufficiency of grace. And we have greater and greater confidence in who you are and in your favor, Lord. So, Lord, bless your people fully and completely. In Jesus' name, amen.